Commandatore!
Commandatore! For you, a Whitman!
No, not
off the bat! I'm so excited
not
to
for,
be
for
here!
Me.
For you!
That's incredible! I wouldn't have expected a Whitman.
Yeah.
And I get to.
You get
is
to
that a sampler?
It. It's a sampler.
Oh, wow. Let me
I got
see.
It for you.
Peanut clusters.
Peanut clusters.
Wow.
I know you like it.
That's amazing. I guess I'll just put it right here.
Yeah, why not?
Welcome to Sopranos Prima Volta. This is a Whitman sampler. It's the perfect gift
what
for
a surprise.
I can't believe it. It's just so quick. That's Ian, by the way. It's Ian. I'm Sam. He hasn't watched the show before. I've watched the show. He hasn't ever seen The Sopranos, but he gave me this Whitman.
So happy to be here at Sam Turelli's.
You know, I was almost impressed. 120 calories, it said, per serving. I said, what's the serving size? It said 2 is the serving size. Who could only eat 2 Whitmans?
Not me.
Come on.
Not me.
Come on. Well, welcome. It is the Prima
Volta.
It is your first time watching The Sopranos.
Yes.
It is my multiple whatever time watching The Sopranos. But today.
Yes.
Today we have to go through episode 8.
Season 4.
Of season 4.
Yeah.
And there's a lot going on here.
Yeah.
A lot.
You know what? Hold the phone. Hold on. Hello?
Oh, that's cute. That's fun.
Yeah. Hi. There is a lot to go on today. Yep. We'll get to it right away. Thanks for calling, Tony. He wanted to make sure we get into it today.
Oh, okay. Did you write that before, like on your way here?
That was like the 5th rough draft.
That's cool.
Version.
That's
yeah. Cool. Hey, a lot of edits.
Can I tell you something?
Huh?
Worked.
Yeah.
I mean, you nailed it.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
Thanks.
Of course. Season 4, episode 8. Mergers and acquisitions.
That's right.
Ian Fidance. And I want to start, I think, this week with the same conversation as last week, which is about Furio.
Yes. And I'd be furious to not mention Comedy Craft Brewery, March 25th, Elmsford, New York, 8 p.m. Come on out. It's near Jersey. I know you a lot of commanditores, gourmands, paisans. Familias are in the area, so come out, say hey, thank you. Furio.
Let's see, March 25th. I think, yeah. Furio is, yeah. I mean, I can't stand the guy.
What?
What is Furio doing?
I will say, Furio has turned into such a whiny little baby.
Like, so he goes home. His dad passed away, so he goes back to Naples for the
And not
funeral.
Only does his dad pass away, but Furio is so dramatic, he goes, his body is riddled with cancer. And Tony goes, okay, you need money? You know, immediately.
Well, I think that is to illustrate the artistic, poetic soul of Furio. You know, like the way Furio has this way with words.
Everything is so dramatic, you know, with this portico and he's outside. He's like, the dick, the grip, and the step on it. You feel the generations of the weight on the grip. It makes the taste feel much better.
It's what makes him so attractive. You have to have moments like that.
Well, you got to be fucking, you know, Mr. Lothario, poet laureate of Italy with a nose like that. You know,
now I feel like you're attacking Furio, which I don't know where that's coming from.
Okay, sorry. You said you hate the guy. I got your back. We're family. The mafias got each other's back.
No, I appreciate that. But I mean, you didn't have to point out that his wife had a 90-pound mole removed from her ass.
Well, you know, he's got a 90-pound mole in his face.
Talk about his nose.
His nose.
No, I just mean because there's so much going for the guy.
Uh-huh.
I think he's a handsome guy.
You want these?
You want By the these? Way, I met him in real life. He did the show.
Really?
Yeah. And he's like a really good painter and everything. He really is like a wonderful artist.
Really?
Yeah.
Is he the one that painted the horse?
We'll get into that.
I like him. I've seen him off camera and he's real likable, fun guy, you know. That's what I love about the show. I mean, obviously actors play a part or whatever. But, like, you know, there's a stereotype of certain actors being, like, dickheads, whatever. It's, like, every character on the show that I look up as an actor, they're the shit. They're, you know, fun, affable, giving people, you know, the guy who plays Ralph, James Pantaleono. How do you say his last name?
Not James, is it?
What? John?
Pants. Joey Pants. Joey Pants. Joe yes. Pantaleano.
He is great. He's got a mental health fund called No Kidding, Me Too.
Yeah, he's the most sensitive,
yeah.
wonderful, warm
That's
man.
What I love, that these people just play these monsters, and they're just, I guess I'm just like describing acting. I'm like, I love acting.
They are specifically good
yes.
actors. Like
yes.
you do have this, even if you don't intend on it, this show more so than a lot, you completely fall into the characters. Like, I mean,
yes.
especially since some of these characters, like you said, Joey Pants and Ralphie could not be more different.
Totally.
When you'd listen to like Michael Imperioli on yeah. Talking Sopranos, like he could not, Michael Imperioli could not be more different than
totally.
Christopher.
Totally.
James Gandolfini, like he doesn't even yeah. sound like Tony. Well, he didn't sound like anything now, but he didn't even oh, sound God. Like Tony at the time.
He doesn't sound like anything now.
Well, I mean, you know, I didn't want to use the wrong tense.
That was really funny. Holy shit, that deserves a Whitman.
Okay. I didn't
realize. You get the Whitman's joke of the day.
I appreciate that. I wasn't even going for it. I didn't know it was a prize.
You nailed it.
Oh, is that a sample?
It's a sample.
Oh, that's incredible.
Yeah, you Look nailed it.
Oh, they got the chocolate nut fudge.
It was fantastic. Okay.
I'll put that right
I
there.
I loved
yeah,
it.
That's a good spot for it.
God.
Oh, you know what we could do, actually?
Uh-huh.
Look at that.
Whoa.
That's good. Yeah, that looks good. That looks
That's
really
great.
Good. No, I mean, you know, like Edie Falco.
Yeah.
She's been on lots of shows. Nothing like
Dude, I was talking to Adam Ferrara, who was on Nurse Jackie with her, and he said that he was wanted to take like an acting class or whatever, and you know, was talking to her and some people in the cast about it. And he took a class and then had like a theater performance, and he said at the end of the show to go out, he looked in the back and Edie and I think like another person from the show were in the crowd and like spent their Sunday just supporting him. And he never asked them to go. He just mentioned that he was doing this thing.
Wow.
Yeah. Just like really good people. Like James Gandolfini, obviously the story about him is he took his pay and reimbursed everyone, like put it back to the people that weren't getting paid enough on the cast.
Yeah.
And then at the very last show, I think they flew out to an award ceremony or whatever, and he gave everyone on the cast gold watches, and underneath it said rest in peace Tony.
First of all, spoiler alert, James.
Second oh, fuck, of all, right. shit.
Second of all,
I didn't even put that together until just now.
I was gonna make a joke about award shows, but we haven't gotten to that episode yet.
Oh boy.
It is, you are going to love it.
No, oh, I love everything
it
about this
so
show.
It is so funny.
But to play these scumbag, irredeemable characters, it goes back to like, well, I really like acting. But I feel like it's very rare that actors, you always hear stories about actors being nightmares or prima donnas or not good people or just like dicks. But it really warms my heart, like when you hear about a rapist in jail getting murdered. Or like a pedophile getting the shit kicked out of me. You're like, wow, there is good in this world.
Right, like it's like karma.
Yeah.
Yeah, it exists.
Yeah, yeah. It's neat. I like it. And especially to be like so good and play someone so bad. That must be like exhilarating for them to like.
You get it out of your system.
Yeah,
like The Purge.
Yeah.
Like that movie, The Purge.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, even, but it's also so, it's rare that you have an ensemble cast this large.
Yes.
That all of them have that quality.
Like, yeah.
That you don't see the actress that plays Janice. You just see this hateable Janice.
Yeah.
You don't see the actor that plays Artie. He's been a character actor forever, but you
right.
just see Artie Bucco. You know, it's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, but, and apparently Artie was like, the guy who played Artie was like friends with everyone on set. Like,
yeah.
everyone loved him and everything. It's like, so, I love that.
Yeah, yeah.
God, I want to be friends with them.
The characters or the actors?
Yeah, like a couple days a week, they play the characters, and then
in
the rest
life.
Of the week, we're like, hey, James.
Right, right. So, well, it's not going to be James, but on like Tuesday and Wednesday, like, you're hanging out with
It's not going to be James. That's a funny joke.
Okay, all right, with the women. I saw you. I went to the wide shots.
You get it back. You deserve it.
You've earned it again. You've earned it. It was a rental, and now you get to keep it. Yeah. Well, no, the reason I get frustrated with Furio here is because he is so head over heels for
Carmella,
which it's like he was an emotionless, stone cold killer.
Yeah, that's right.
When he moved to Jersey. Like, I mean, no feelings, no emotions.
That's right. That's why Tony loved him.
Exactly.
Now he's a softy.
So he goes to Naples. Carmella misses him while he's in Naples. She misses him, which has always been Carmella's MO. I'm not surprised by that from Carmella. But to see him so head over heels that he actually vocalizes his feelings. We're in the mafia.
Yeah.
We don't vocalize our feelings.
I kind of like that he does that.
Really?
I like that he's in touch with his emotions, and maybe he's starting a new precedent for a newer, softer, emotional mafia.
No, I don't. I think he just wants to have sex with the boss's wife.
I think you're right.
And he's talking to his uncle, and he's telling his uncle that he's in love with the boss's wife. That's nuts.
Yeah. Like, insane.
But he just wants to
talk
about it.
But then, wait a minute. What is he doing? He brings everyone back a gift, but not her?
Because I think the reason that he doesn't bring Carmella back a gift is because he brings...
He knows where it'll go.
No, I think that... Mm-hmm. My gifts are so good. Uh-huh. You put them...
In your pussy.
I don't think so. That's ridiculous.
You've never gotten a gift so good you put it...
I've never put it in mine. It's insane. Mm. I've gotten good gifts.
Things are a little different for Italians from Delaware.
I just got two boxes of Whitman's.
Well, you better get the stretching, pal.
It's disgusting. Look, no, I think that the gifts that he brought back for everybody, meaningless gifts.
Yeah.
Like tokens.
Yeah.
Just
a little Geppetto for AJ.
Yeah, he brought him back for manners, just because it's what you're supposed to do. I think that he knew that there would be too much feeling associated. Like, if you were going to get a gift for Carmella.
Yeah, if you're crying over sunglasses left at the house, good God, what's going to happen when you bring her back a apron or something?
Right. He knows that he would give the gift, and it would be a gift filled with love.
Mm.
And he can't give that gift.
Yeah.
So instead, he just gets real fucking weird.
I need to keep my foot on the pedal. What?
Yeah, I don't know what he's thinking. I don't know why he's made this change. I don't know how Carmella did this to him. She really turned him inside out.
Oh, yeah. I hope he still has the ability to kill.
I don't know if he does, to tell you the truth. If I don't trust him to kill right now.
Mm.
Do you?
I'm worried that there might be an incident later that he doesn't act fast enough and let something happen to Tony.
Oh, and then if he lets something happen to Tony, do you think Tony starts to put the pieces together?
Maybe.
Or, I mean, the watch said RIP Tony.
Yeah, I mean, we know Tony dies in the end or something. Something happens to Tony in the end.
Is it possible?
I know. How can you live on Earth without knowing whatever? But
is it possible that that's Furio related?
Oh, wow.
I'm asking you now.
Maybe. I thought maybe Furio could be related to some sort of gun exchange like what happened in season one with Tony.
I mean, I'll ask you this.
Whoa.
You saw the car commercial, right?
Yes.
Meadow and AJ were together, right?
Uh-huh.
Not Carmella, though, right?
What?
Is it possible she's in Naples with Furio? I don't know. I'm asking.
Huh.
Because the car commercial we decided is canon.
Right.
Because David Chase directed it, the whole deal.
Yes. And the next commercial is them picking me up to hang out.
Yeah. I mean, clearly Ian is going to be not like join the Soprano family, but be very close friends.
Yeah.
Like you're not going to be in the mafia, but you're going to be real close.
No, it's like when like your parents have a best friend, you call them aunt and uncle, but you're not really related. I'm like, I'll be like the best family friend.
I thought that you were going to be the new Paul Dano. You know how AJ's best friend was Paul Dano?
First of all, it's Dano.
I've heard it both ways.
Well,
I'll tell you who's losing it.
Me?
Yeah, for sure. Well, besides you, Paulie trying to keep his mother in that home.
Oh my God, dude.
Paulie is looking out for his mom's.
Paulie is so done. He goes to this woman's His mom's, first of all, I love how when he sees Cookie. His mom's friends, he goes, you know, it's funny. When I was younger, you were old women. And then now I'm older and you're still old women. How's your kid?
He thought he was being charming.
Yeah. Paulie is such a moron. And then his mom is not getting, oh God, his poor mom. It makes me so sad to see her and how she interacts. And
she's ostracized.
Oh, I don't like that. They should include her.
They don't like her.
Why?
She's lame. You didn't feel that she was lame?
Well, she forgets her T's sometimes. That's so lame. Paulie finds out, he goes, this is not good. Which I love.
Like, because he kind of gets that his mom is lame.
And then she's ratting on people, and it's like, oh, I wonder where he gets it from.
Wow.
Hmm.
Wow.
Yep.
So he finds the guy that he knew when he was a kid.
And calls that guy's mom a malignant cunt. Jesus, Paulie.
Well, he's a school principal now. So he goes to visit him at work. And he says that, you know, his mom needs to be friends with Paulie's mom. And the guy was like, I don't know what to tell you, because the guy is functioning like a rational adult. That is like, this isn't a thing. I'm not going to tell my mom to be friends with your mom. You're out of your mind.
Yeah. And of course, Paulie is like, you know, my mother always had my back. And I had my ways, but I could slip back.
And he's like, what are you talking about? Like, this is, we're talking about our mothers being friends here.
In a nursing home. Grow up.
But Paulie doesn't know any way besides the organized crime way.
Yeah.
So he sends little Paulie and his goons into the school.
To beat the shit out of the principal.
Hunt down the principal and break his arm.
And those kids probably got kicked out of that school.
Probably.
By the principal.
Not that principal, but a principal.
Yeah.
But now that principal's got a broken arm.
Yeah. And he can't even ask his mom. He has to have his wife do the bidding.
The wife goes
He got beat up by two teenagers, and now you got your wife doing your bidding, you fucking cuck loser.
Would you put him in the Artie Bucco category? That high school principal?
Yeah. I mean, he probably went in to talk to his mom and was like, kick a seat, man.
Jump the leap.
Jump the leap. Kick a seat.
Yeah, he has to have his mom go in, and his mom, I mean, not his mom, might as well be his mom,
wife.
His
wife, really.
Can you imagine if your daughter-in-law, the woman that your son married, who, by the way, there's no way that mother and that daughter-in-law get along. They never did.
Well, she mentions it in the beginning of the episode. She's like, but that daughter-in-law, and Cookie's like, after all you've done for her or whatever, she hates her, and she's the one asking for the favor.
Well, the daughter-in-law doesn't ask for a favor.
She tells her.
The daughter-in-law tells her, and she says that if she is not friends with Paulie's mom,
she's going to go to the Salvation Army. Jesus Christ.
I got some mob guys after me. Like, wouldn't you think that was a lie if your spouse came to you and said, look, I'm not involved with the mafia at all, but I have some mob guys after me, and they broke my arm, and they've said if my mom isn't friends with their mom, they'll continue to hurt me.
That is such a childish
thing
with such adult consequences. It's juvenile, completely.
But and I the wife goes like, okay, and she takes care of it. I feel like on some level she's got to think that her husband's lying to her, but he's not.
Yeah. Well, isn't it funny too how when we see Paulie see the principal for the first time, he's sitting next to a boy with detention, and it puts them together as like these two, you know, misbehaved boys.
Yeah, and it goes
like he's an adult. They don't make him wait in the office or anywhere. He has to sit next to the Paulie is that kid. Paulie is a bad, immature brat.
Boy. He's a boy. And it goes back to what you were saying, I think, last week about the state of arrested development.
Totally.
That everyone is in.
Well, Tony even admits it. When Tony meets Valentina and she makes Ralphie step in horse shit, Tony's like, well, my sense of humor is one making an 8-year-old boy laugh. And it's like, yeah, no coincidence. That's when you start to pass out when you see deli meat.
Yeah, we'll get to Valentina in a second. I also think it's interesting in this episode that Tony, for a second, tries to be the strong silent type. To me, the strong silent type is that dark, brooding mafia figure, right. Stoic, that is what Tony wants to be. Mm-hmm. Like the idea that Tony speaks seldom. Mm-hmm. And only to Christopher is the strong silent type.
Mm-hmm.
But Tony is—he can't do it. He's bored by it.
No, he wants to be Paul Cicero from Goodfellas.
Yeah, exactly. He wants to micromanage everything. Yeah.
He's more like a Joe Pesci.
That's a great call. He wants to be Paulie, who everybody fears but respects because he's fair.
Yeah,
but Tony is not a fair person, and he's just an angry, jealous
hothead.
Yeah.
He's
like Joe Pesci if Joe Pesci were much bigger.
Yeah. Tony is Joe Pesci if Joe Pesci got made that day instead of getting popped in the back of the head. I'm sorry for spoilers.
And also full size. Joe Pesci's a small man.
Oh, not an indomitable spirit.
No, yeah. Joe Pesci's spirit is as large as anyone I've ever known. But in terms of stature.
You know me, so. No. You could have just said as large as your spirit, Ian.
No, I mean, wouldn't have put you in that category.
Really?
I mean, it's, yeah, no.
Oh. Oh, shit. Fuck.
What? You can't do this. What? This can't be a thing. Like, this can't be. I can't feel that pressure.
Who's got a big spirit?
It's not. Ian.
Yeah.
So much pressure
for
me to sit here for the whole show and wonder, am I saying the right thing? Because I don't want to lose one of my witnesses. Joe Pesci does have a very financial spirit. Huge.
Wow.
I appreciate this.
You're welcome. You've earned it.
I just hate feeling like I have to keep earning it.
You just said the key word, earning. We all earn around here. We all get to carry our weight. So
Tony
can't
handle being that guy at all.
No.
No, he can't. He can't. And do you think that there will ever be a time when Tony just speaks through Christopher?
No, and also he tries, and Christopher fucks it up each time. The first scene in this episode is him calling Christopher, laying off all these orders and terms, and Christopher's taking the note on a pillow. Are you fucking serious? This is going to be the head of the mafia? And Tony knows it. He hangs up the phone, and he's just standing on the side of the turnpike like, what am I doing? It's like Tony can see this empire falling through his fingers.
Do you think, okay, first of all, they didn't have the notes app yet, so lay off Christopher.
This motherfucker doesn't know to have a notepad next to him with a pen and paper.
The pillow was a light pillow.
writing on a pillow. Have you ever tried to sign a t-shirt? It is so hard.
That's a great call. It'd be so hard to read the pillow back.
Dude, yeah, I know. And then Christopher's so dumb, he probably wouldn't just bring the pillowcase. He'd bring the pillow.
The whole pillow.
Yeah.
Do you think, okay, that's a great thing. Tony watching the empire fall between his fingers. Do you think the reason that's falling through his fingers, is it truly because there is no, he can't find the right successor because Christopher's not the guy? Or is it because Tony's not the guy?
Wow. Wish I had another thing of Whitman's to give you. That's a good point.
I would accept it, but it comes with such pressure.
Speaking of pressure, I don't think you could last in the mafia.
Okay, you're right. You're right.
You just earned another Whitman's.
Thank you.
By the time the show is over, God forbid, I want you sitting on a throne of Whitman's.
We're going to have to, at the end of the show.
Yes.
You know we're going to have to show every box of Whitman's that was presented throughout the show.
A Whitman's montage.
Yeah. No. I mean, have the physical boxes here on display.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so totally. All of them.
Totally. I think...
Yeah, do you think it's the future is in danger, or do you think it's because the present leadership is lacking?
I think it's both, but Tony is so headstrong, he's not going to admit that he is wrong. It's someone else's fault.
Tony's almost like Carmella in that sense of, in that denial that he just kind of lives with to avoid the truth that he doesn't want to deal with.
Right, but also
it's a different truth, obviously, but
Tony's building up this house of cards, leaving it in Christopher's hand, but at the same time, he is, you know, stacking the cards in a faulty manner. You know, he's beating...
It's a lot of metaphors.
He's beating Zelman.
That's Irina. He feels for her.
Yeah, but he's like, he's fucking himself over. And then it's like, you know...
Let's get into it. Let's get into his emotions and the fact that, like, he lays eyes, that he's sitting there, he's completely taking Paiomai away from Ralphie. That's Tony's horse.
Yeah.
Ralphie bought it.
Dude, can we stop introducing people and things to Tony? Just isolate this man. Keep everything away from him because he will covet, he will take, he will steal, and make his.
Can you imagine if I had Tony over here and I was like, you know, that's Mick Foley's shirt from WrestleMania. And he'd go, oh, is it? And
then yeah.
I'd go like this. Oh, yep. No.
Yep.
I shouldn't have showed him.
Yep.
I shouldn't have showed him.
It is every instance and interaction he has with someone is, it goes back to Ralph rewarding him for the horse, giving him a little money, not realizing what he just did. And then Tony keeping his hand out for more money and not even looking at Ralph.
Mm-hmm.
It is just, I mean, this guy, and it's funny too, because when Gandolfini lays down and sometimes he kind of looks like an alligator, like a crocodile with like his nose and his little teeth.
Yeah.
And that's what he is. He's just chomp, chomp, chomping away.
That's right. Just right there on the surface, yep. Just watching, waiting for his next meal.
Yeah.
And Valentina is that next meal. Valentina shows up. Tony's getting new horseshoes put on...
Paiomai.
Put on Paiomai that I'm sure Ralphie will pay at least half for, if not the whole load.
Plus, Ralphie's got to get his own shoes because Valentina makes him step in shit.
Now, do you think... clearly Valentina made Ralphie step in shit so that Ralphie had to leave to clean his shoes so that she could talk to Tony, yes?
I didn't think of that. I just thought Valentina was a little prankster.
I think she wanted to prank Ralphie specifically in front of Tony. I think that she is a climber. I think she's a climber.
Interesting.
And I think she also has a sixth sense. Something that she's good at is she immediately saw the way Tony was looking at her and realized, like, sleeping with Ralphie is good.
Mm-hmm.
Sleeping with the boss.
Right, right.
You know, is even better.
Well, of course.
She's right there with the flirtation immediately.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And Tony is too. You know, he sinks his teeth into her and, you know, they go and it's funny. I noticed like Tony gets that sound system at his house.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, it sounds like Clapton's right in your living room. And then he like becomes a master of his domain there, wakes up, and immediately forgets just how much he has, and he has to go out and get more, which is why he calls Valentina.
Yeah, I mean, 2 weeks ago, you went on your whole thing about comparison being the robber,
theft of joy.
That's literally Tony's entire life. He goes and he buys this painting just so he can spend time with Valentina and, like, have an excuse
Pays
for it.
Pays cash. $6,500 cash. And then he Photoshops Ralph out. He's like, get this guy out of here. You know.
It's his horse.
It's
and
his
Valentina's
horse.
Valentina's his horse, too.
Oh, and he's going to ride her.
Yeah, well, before he can ride her, though.
Give her a sugar cube full of cock.
What?
What? It was a metaphor.
Okay. It was a good metaphor.
Yeah.
It was a good metaphor. It's good. You did a good job.
Oh, okay.
You did a good job.
Yes.
Yeah, but before he can put his sugar cube in her
full of
penis.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Before he can do that.
Yes.
He has to get past. He I believe he hooks up with her once. And
right.
Then he can't do it again. And it's not because he has a moral objection to her being Ralphie's girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
It's because he's disgusted by the idea of Ralphie's pee in her V. You know what I mean? Like, he's got to find out the exact details on her sex life because he doesn't feel comfortable sleeping with her until he finds out that Ralph is involved in masochism and is not actually penetrating Valentina.
I didn't see it that way.
How did you see it?
I saw it as this was a way for Tony to clear his conscience. You know, just getting the... How does he find out initially that Ralphie is, like, not regular sexual?
Well, Valentina tells him.
Right.
Right, because he goes, I can't be with you.
Well, Tony cuts it off because he's learning his lessons with Gumars to not lead them on, quote unquote, to not lead them on. And he gets and he writes a note to Modi, by the way, hilarious cameo.
And love Modi.
Modi's great. Shout out Modi. And he goes, give me another card. And then this time he adds, sincerely.
Because he doesn't want to lead her on.
Yeah, well,
look,
that's the thing.
It's baby steps.
It's baby steps. He initially wants to cut it off because his last Gumar killed herself and he doesn't want any sort of thing like that again. But that's when she starts to tell him about the sexual aspect of Ralph. And then Tony needs more so that he can excuse his behavior because, well, she's not getting it from Ralph. And, you know, I gotta, it makes more sense. I'm not taking from him because he's not giving.
I see.
And I feel like it has nothing to do with, like, Ralph and a disgust about his penis and her vagina. More so it's a way of Tony clearing his conscience.
I could see it. I see it that way for sure. I also, there was something, because Tony does have a visceral disgust for Ralph. So right. I guess that's where I was drawing from.
Well, which is so funny because he brings it up to Syl.
Yeah.
And he goes, is Ralph weird with women? And Syl's like, well, you know, he beat a woman to death with the bare hands because, I don't even remember. Why was that? It's like, that's such a funny answer.
Yeah.
Like, again, Ralph is the most despicable person.
Yeah.
But as a character, he is my favorite. He's just so, like...
He's incredible.
Him going, is he weird with women? He goes, well, you know, he did beat a woman to death with his bare hands, but...
Why was that?
What? I don't know. It's just so fucking ridiculous.
But how weird is it that Tony then has to go to Janice get the scoop on Ralph sexually, which is also getting the scoop on his sister sexually.
Dude, and not only that, he gets Valentina, and she's like, you want me to rub his dick with a cheese grater, and la la la. And then he goes, okay, let me take this and bring it to Melfi. And then he, like, makes Melfi take a session longer than normal to get this, like, he needs... Like the okay, a multiple tiered okay.
Which is the exact same thing he was doing when he was trying to get somebody to say that he's a good person.
Wow.
He's looking for somebody, anyone,
yes.
just some loophole.
Instead of owning it himself.
Right. Just create a loophole so that I can do this without any consequence that I would put on myself.
Yes.
It's Tony
totally.
To a T.
Totally.
And everybody's like, there's no loophole here until you're right. And this, like, masochism thing, putting candle wax on his balls and cheese graters, that is somehow his loophole.
Yes, and he goes through Melfi, then he gets, you know, Janice, goddamn, shakes him down for $3,000, which is hilarious, and then she gets, immediately tells him.
Right.
But she plays the whole, like, you're asking me to betray confidences. It's like, lady,
so
you're trying to get your new boyfriend to eat his dead wife's ziti. Fuck you.
That's true. She did do that.
You fucking snake pig. I love you. You're such a good actress.
Yeah.
Ada Todorova's amazing.
She should have left that. They should have left the ziti in the freezer for, I mean, a year plus.
God, that's so sick.
Yeah. Maybe on the anniversary of the death. That's what you do for wedding cake. You know, you put it in the freezer and then a year first anniversary, you eat the cake. You don't wait 3 weeks until Janice comes in and pressures you before you're ready.
No. But Tony needs that okay before he can, you know, that weird psychological thing. And he even told her, he goes, well, I already took his horse. You fucking scumbag.
He's a bad guy.
Yeah. Yeah. And at the same time, Carmela's freaking out. Because she talks to Ro with the diaper drive and this and that. So then Carmela starts stealing his money.
Wow.
Because Carmela finds a broken nail in his pocket, which some could say is a metaphor for a nail in the coffin.
You think that's the final nail in the coffin?
It's a nail. Wait, you think one nail goes into a coffin?
No, but the metaphor, you go, that's the final nail in the coffin. Nobody says, like, that's a single nail in the coffin. You don't go, like, calculate things that way. When something bad happens, you go, that was the final nail in the coffin. That's the final straw.
I think in a way, like, Tony needs the psychological mental gymnastics of, like, the okay to fuck Valentina.
But that's not a metaphor to be, like, that's one of many nails in the coffin. That's not a metaphor.
Well, it's an exact nail in the coffin of finally, let me finish, of finally giving herself the okay to steal the money and take it into her own hands.
So that is the final nail in the coffin being Carmela's ability to take the money out of the birdseed?
No, it's a nail, a real life nail.
It's a fingernail.
A fingernail.
Not a nail. You nail a coffin.
But the metaphor is that it's a nail in a coffin.
But the metaphor wouldn't be a nail. No, you're right. You would.
Tell me I made a good point.
You made a really good point. I mean, you made
thanks, man. I appreciate it. Thanks for giving me this. Whitman's.
Put it here for now. I hear that all the time. That was one of many nails in the coffin. Definitely. Definitely is probably exactly what David Chase was going for. yeah, but that nail. Okay, here's why I love the nail. Number one, I do love the idea. It also answers your question from a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. You go, where does all this cash just come from?
Right.
Carmela just takes $40,000, and it's not half of it. It's not close to half of it. It's just, she just skims a little off the top.
Right.
And it's $40,000 that she just takes out of the bird seed. Mm-hmm. She invests it. By the way, Carmela, again, criminally smarter, and by criminally smarter, I mean intelligent when it comes to criminal activities.
Oh, the 9,990.
So funny.
Yeah.
And when the banker goes,
interesting.
You know that there's a limit to, and she goes like this. Oh, really? Oh. I didn't know.
Hilarious.
Really great. I love that. It also, I think, to people who, on an emotional level, just want Carmela to get a win, I feel like Carmela investing the money in those increments is a win for Carmela. Finally, this stretching of the rules is working in Carmela's favor, which I think is refreshing for people.
Right, but it's like, you know, one step forward, two steps back. At the same time, we see her watching Mario Batali. And she just goes into a trance over his ponytail, thinking of Furio.
Oh, Carmela.
Which is just Carmela. God.
Mario Batali, just the least attractive.
He got me too'd.
Gross. He was gross before the Me Too stuff.
Yeah, he's just always like greasy looking, and he kind of looks like a, you know, like a weird ponytailed pig.
He does. And it turns out he was a weird ponytailed pig.
Totally.
And just a big, giant pig.
Yeah.
But so
he's like if Janice was a person in real life.
Janice is that bad? The character, of course.
The character, not the actress. She's an angel.
You love the actress.
I'd marry her.
You would?
You're watching.
So, that's beautiful, man. Mm-hmm. That's beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Carmela dumping all the money, right?
Right.
And she puts the money away. But she also, and talk about, you know, just mental warfare, not even gymnastics, warfare, leaving the nail on the bedside table.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I thought, man, wasn't that like a while ago? So she took it and then put it back. And then Tony knows. Huh.
Because she knows that Tony is back with Agumar.
Mm-hmm.
She also knows that Tony knows that she took the money.
Mm-hmm.
She knows that Tony's not going to not notice all that money being
missing. Right. And also you mentioned the Agumar, and when she's talking to Ro at the drive, she goes, I finally made peace with all this Gumar shit. And then it's like, did ya?
You didn't.
Did ya?
But Carmela was lying about that. But let's go back one episode.
Mm-hmm.
Tony is whipping a business partner, a councilman,
right,
in his own bedroom because the councilman had the nerve to sleep with a woman.
And date and treat well
a woman
Tony's ex-Gumar.
Tony was, his mistress from years before.
Mm-hmm.
One episode later, Tony is having sex with his family, mafia family members, Gumar.
Mm.
And feels no guilt about it because of a cheese grater. He doesn't put himself, I would really not like this if somebody did it to me.
Yeah.
He doesn't that. So, but I just love the end of this episode because there's just this silence between Tony and Carmella. Because I said, Tony knows because he specifically found the nail.
Mm-hmm.
Tony knows that Carmella took the money.
Yes.
Tony knows that Carmella knows that he has cheated.
Gumar, yes.
Tony knows that Carmella knows that Tony knows that he cheated. Carmella over here knows that Tony knows all that. Carmella also knows that Tony knows that she took that money. And both of them are aware of all of this. And neither one of them will say what they did because of the consequences.
Yeah. And also, speaking of knows, Carmella brings AJ to Furio's again.
Oh. And by the way, if Carmella was watching this episode, she'd hear me say knows so many times, she'd go,
oh yeah, she'd go into a trance.
Yeah.
She'd just go slip sliding down the fucking wherever she is.
That's true. Carmella does go to Furio's house.
She does. And that's before she talks to Ro and tells Ro, as Furio told his uncle, I have a thing, this and that, you know, for Furio. And Ro is like, don't do it, la, la, la. But again, I said that thing about AJ because Carm brings AJ to Furio's. AJ goes, why do I always have to come? And then he's like, you told me we go to CompUSA.
CompUSA.
Yeah, yeah. Insane reference.
It's so great.
Insane reference. And then, again, poor AJ at the end of what you were just talking about with that insane psychological mental chess warfare game that's going on. AJ comes down. Tony sees an opportunity to rope AJ into it and goes, been out in the backyard lately?
Oh. Oh. I'm going to ask you a complicated question.
And AJ knows, speaking of people knowing,
go ahead.
AJ knows and goes, I'm going back upstairs.
He doesn't want anything to do with it. He knows it's a game.
Yep.
And that's dangerous. When the kid knows that they're being used as a pawn in this weird game between the parents, that's so toxic. Do you think that Carmella is mad at Tony because he's seeing a Gumar? Or do you think that Carmella is mad at Tony because he's seeing a Gumar and her love for Furio is unrequited? Meaning, are Carmella's feelings really, like, because she's obviously feeling so strongly that she's playing mental warfare. She's leaving this thing on the thing. She's stealing the money from Tony. Do you think this is about Tony stepping out on the marriage, or do you think this is about Carmella not being able to hook up with Furio?
Well, they have a moment in his kitchen.
Yes.
Where they talk about communication and love. And
yes.
They have a deep eye contact. And then AJ, CompUSA.
So is she mad at Tony for cheating on her, or is she mad at Tony for not being Furio? You see?
I think she's mad at Tony for cheating, and she thinks to absolve, again, it comes back to money, to absolve that feeling of Tony cheating, I'm upset, let me steal his money and do what I do. Wow, I feel better. And I don't know if she's mad. Maybe the thing is, yeah, you can have a Gumar, but I can't.
And it's Furio. She's in love. Don't forget she's in love with him.
Yeah. Wow, yeah.
And she knows that not only can she not be with Furio because she's married to Tony,
mm-hmm.
but also because Furio works for Tony. Like, right. It's not just the fact
right.
that she can't upset her vows of marriage. It's that even if she wanted to upset her vows of marriage, Furio would die.
And again, that happened with the handyman.
Vic.
Yeah. When she was like,
what a handsome guy, right?
Vic. I'd like to give him a sugar cube of dick.
What?
Call back. Did you like it? Nay. I think.
I like that one.
Like again. Carm was like, oh, you thank you for making the right decision. And then I forget who was like, no, he did it because it, I think it was Syl's wife, was like, he did it because of who Tony is. Yeah. So again, Tony is cock blocking
yep.
her by having even like a tryst or whatever, just a break from what it is. He's trapped and imprisoned her just by existing.
Yes. However, these are the negatives. She doesn't mind all the positives. She doesn't mind nice house. She doesn't mind everything else.
Totally.
Well, look, guys.
And can I just say real quick?
Yeah.
That is, I had to rewind multiple times the ending of that episode of just the coyness and the knowledge. And again, this show is all about, I wish I had the book here, Marone, Italian without words.
Italian without words.
Of him going, her going, you sure there's nothing you want to talk about? And he goes, no. Like what? And he says it in this, like what?
It's like something right out of your apartment.
Woo!
Yeah.
What?
What?
Huh? You're on the books for maybe not getting a thing of Whitman's next week.
Well, guys, pray for me. Pray for Whitman's. Be here next week.
Be a good Catholic for 15 fucking minutes and pray for Sammy Queers.
That's not what anybody calls me. We're going to be at episode 9 next week. I've seen it before. It'll be Ian's Prima Volta. Don't forget, don't make it your Prima Volta in the comments. Be in there regularly. Talk amongst yourselves. Let us know what you thought of this episode, not only of The Sopranos, but of Prima Volta. Hit like. Don't forget the 25th, if you're watching this when the episode comes out, that's tomorrow, to go see Ian the Fidance. And where are you going to be?
Elmsford, New York.
New York, baby.
iAnimal 69. Tickets available there. I'm posting about it. Come say hey. Come at the Tory. Give me a fat fucking envelope.
Or just a box of Whitman's.
Yeah, I'll take some Whitman's.
As long as it's a sampler.
As long as it's a sampler.
I can't wait. I'm loving talking about this episode.
Yeah.
But I can't wait to talk about next week's episode, because even though I've seen it many times before for you, it'll be your
Prima Volta.